out. So I shout out your name. From the rooftops I proclaim that I am yours. I am yours.
Do we stand on the rooftops? Amen. Are we ready to shout out that name of Jesus to the world? When we go into a place where the darkness dwells, are we ready to say the name of Jesus? Are we ready to testify about the King we serve? Or are we ones that just blend in and become like the rest so that we are unnoticed Christians? Are we those that say, Lord, I want to shout out from the rooftops that I am yours, that I belong to you? I don't have to blend in when my identity is Jesus. I don't need to have affirmation of other people or feel like I have to be like them or feel like I need to be liked by them. My first identity must be in Jesus Christ above all things. That's where I find who I really am, in the anchor for my soul. Then I don't need to prove anything to people. Then I don't need to be anything else to people except a light. Hallelujah. And we still meet people where they are. We're not talking about being super religious. I'm talking about being a witness. I'm talking about living out your faith. Can I share something with you just while you're standing for a moment? You know, we did a wedding yesterday, and I want to just share with you that was such a wonderful surprise for me, is that the couple that we married have just recently experienced a touch of Holy Spirit, recently experienced. It's not even something familiar. Amen? And yet when they gave their speeches at a completely secular wedding, the one person stood up. In fact, both of them mentioned the Lord, but the one person stood up and she said, "You know that every morning and every evening, my now wife and I, we pray together. We pray together. And the Lord is very important in our lives. God plays a very important role." For people that are not seasoned, that haven't been attending this church, that haven't been educated or given knowledge or explained or taught or learnt in home groups how to testify, that came straight out of the heart of someone that had experienced Christ on a deeper level, no matter if it was once, no matter if it was yesterday, no matter if it was a week ago, and was not afraid, even in front of the most hardened hearts, perhaps, in some cases, because hearts grow cold and hard. It's not a judgment. It's just how we become, you know, when we're not in the Lord. And for people to hear that, some people, I think, were probably even shocked. They probably didn't even know that. So to say that as part of your speech, to testify to Christ, to bring Christ's name in, you don't Bible punch people. You are talking about your own experiences, right? And so never be afraid to share the truth of who you are. The word says we must share the truth of who we are. And you know, when we're not coming from that place of overflow, it's hard to shout it from the rooftops. You know, when we drained and exhausted and we need to be refueled, it's hard to shout it from the rooftops, right? Isn't it? Yeah. So now we come to a place where we say, "Listen, you know what, Lord? Make me one that is able to, that has a desire to run up to a rooftop and shout out your name and say, Lord, people, world, hear me. I am yours. Jesus, I am yours." And to all that would hear and to all that would listen, "I am yours. And if I have anything to prove, Lord, it's that I am a king's kid. If I have anything to prove, it's to bring your light to the world, to bring people to a place of seeing who you are so that there is hope for them too." I've been like the world all my life. But now it's time to live in Christ. Christ in me, the hope of glory. That people see Christ in me, the hope of glory. That where I go, I don't fit into that atmosphere. I change it. I change it not by my own charisma or my own bringing attention to myself, but just because it's in me. Because he's in you. He's in you. He's the hope of glory. And you can do anything. You can do anything through that name. You can do anything through who he is in you. Don't worry about who you are. Don't worry about what you look like. Don't worry about what you haven't yet accomplished. Don't worry about the things that you... "Gosh, I've got to improve in this area and I've got to do this. And oh, I've let the Lord down in that area." And, oh, listen, don't let the devil talk to you. Hallelujah. Say, "You know what? Christ in me. Christ in me. Through Christ in me, I can do all things. It doesn't matter about my inadequacy. It doesn't matter about my problems. It doesn't matter about my struggles. It doesn't matter about my idiosyncrasies. It doesn't even matter about my sin and the issues I have. It matters that Christ in me is the hope of glory. It matters that no matter what's going on, if I portray Christ to the world, that's what's going to manifest. That's what's going to change the atmosphere." Hallelujah. So even if the devil's reminding you and saying, "Oh, you can't change that atmosphere. Look at your life. Look at who you are. Oh, who are you?" Christ in me. Christ in me. The hope of glory. Through Christ, I can do all things. All things. things, all things. Nothing is impossible. Tell your neighbor, Christ in you, glory. Come on. Christ in you, Christ in you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The devil's got you all wound up. What are you going to do? How are you going to do it? You're not the pastor. You don't have any power. Look at your life. Look at what's going on behind closed doors. The pastor doesn't see that. How are you going to portray Christ? Listen, devil, get behind me. It's because of who I am that I need Christ. And that's why it's Christ in me that does the changing. Hallelujah. And while Christ's busy changing me, I can be used to change the world. Hallelujah. If Christ wanted perfect people, then we would have all let you die on the cross. Sorry, I'm just saying. Difference is we wouldn't have risen again. But Christ in me, the hope of glory, the hope of the world. Amen. So you got to say to yourself this morning, Lord, during this season, no matter what's going on in my life, let my winding down not be a cooling off from you, but let my winding down be one where I'm accumulating in my spirit that overflow of your spirit. I'm accumulating as much as I can draw off you in this time and in this season that will sustain me, and not only sustain me, but fill me up so that I'm overflowing, because out of the overflow of the heart speaks. So you got to make sure what's in your heart is what's in the Lord's heart. You got to make sure that the overflow is an authenticity that comes with your identity in Christ, not your identity, not who you were. You know, everyone in this place knows, and on the live stream, all of you know when you're moving into the old. You know when that old self rears its head. Amen? You know it. You can feel it. You can say a sentence and you know it. But that's when you say, Lord, please take over. Lord, please, 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 just take over. Take that away. I take that right now. And Lord, I come and I say, you in me, Lord. Christ in me, the hope of glory. Christ in me, Lord. More of you, God. More of you. And believe that God will restore you and shift you and move you into that dimension of glory. Because it doesn't matter who you and I are. The Lord went, Jesus, when he walked the earth, he went among the tax collectors. He went among those that the Pharisees turned their noses up and they said, how can he go and mix with those people? But you see, Jesus knew who he was. He knew that when he went into that kind of environment that he would change. Not everybody. He didn't convince everybody, right? Because there were people that always came to criticize him and they eventually killed him. The very people that were part of his own nation killed him. We can thank them. Hallelujah. It was all part of the plan because God knew it. But he changed atmospheres for those who had ears to hear and eyes to see. There were many lives. We read the stories all over the world of people's lives that were changed. And you and I, all we need to have is eyes to see and ears to hear, and God will touch our hearts. And even more now, the Bible says, how much more than for you and I in this New Testament type church have the Holy Spirit to bring transformation in our lives. Christ in you. Christ in you. Don't let the devil get a hold on that old. You just tell him, get behind me. I'm a new creation. And I'm a work in progress, but I'm getting there. And I'm going to move into the fullness of what God has for me. And nothing can stop what God has for me. Because every single one of my days were written in the book of life. Every single one of my days was ordained by God before one of them came to be. And I'm not going to listen to the way that my parents kept striking me down and telling me how terrible I was and how useless I am and can't I get myself together. And all of those things, words that might echo in your spirit, it didn't happen to me. I'm just sharing with you. Amen. I'm sharing because some of us have experienced those things where we feel useless. How can we make a difference? But I'm telling you, Christ in you is the hope of glory. Christ in you. Friends, God's going to use, God used fisher people. God used fisher people. Do you think God's not going to use us? Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. God's not interested in worldly ways. God's interested in your heart. In your heart. When the world thinks nothing of you, when the enemy makes nothing of you, remember Christ in you is your hope and your light and your glory. Hallelujah. Isn't that a good word? Amen. Praise you, Jesus. Are we singing one more song? Hallelujah. Stand with us if you can, if you're willing. I mean, if you want to, if you can.
Just a memory, and tears are no more. I believe the Lord would say to us this morning, we need to look at God to see our beauty.
Yes.
We don't see ourselves in the beauty of God. And we're singing that song to the Lord this morning.
Yes.
But I believe God is saying to each one of us this morning that you're beautiful. You, my child,
yes,
my son, my daughter, you are beautiful. Just fix your eyes on me.
Yes.
I believe the Lord would say to us this morning,
yes,
see your beauty.
Yes.
Stop seeing yourself the way that the world has said you are.
Jesus.
Distorted images.
Beautiful.
To go in Jesus' name.
To me. You're beautiful, you're beautiful, you're beautiful to me. What the word was this morning. That the Lord is saying, if you look to me, as you magnify my name, you'll find your beauty in me. You'll find your beauty in me. I'm the restorer. I'm the restorer of everything, the Lord would say. As you say, Lord, you're beautiful, so you will see the beauty you have. So you will see the beauty and see yourself the way I see you. Thank you, Jesus. Before we move into the word, although we've had a lot of word, I just want to ask right now, sort of my heart this morning, and usually if something shifts and moves and then the Lord brings it back to me, it was meant to be. If I have forgotten about it in the flesh, God moves my heart again. So if ever you have a word that you feel God's releasing, never fear, because if it's something that's meant to be spoken, it'll always come back to you. Amen. And I just want right now, every single couple right now, to come up here. If you want me to pray, I need to pray over relationships this morning. Every couple, just come and stand here very quickly. Very quickly, just come stand here. Those, not every couple, but every couple that wants to. Just come and stand here. All we want to do is pray over your relationships. Just come up right now. Come stand here. Yeah, just let's form a line over here. Come over here. Hallelujah. We'll go in stages. All right, we just want to lay hands on you. Hallelujah. Take your hands of your partner. Take your hands of your husband or your wife or your... Hallelujah. There's on relationships this morning. There's an anointing on relationships. I want to tell you right now, the enemy will make you your head spin. Okay? In destroying relationships. Okay? You've got to look to God, the author and founder of your faith. You've got to say, Lord, be the restorer of every relationship. Doesn't matter how long you've been married. It doesn't matter how long you've been together. It doesn't even matter how in love you are. I'm saying, let God restore things in your relationship right now that need restoring to bring that relationship. God is the God of reconciliation in every area. I tell you what, the Spirit of God came upon me this morning, and I said to Prophet M that this is what we needed to do. So right now, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we solidify, listen, the vows that you made how many years ago. I want you to remember what those were. Yesterday I spoke about compromise in the word that I gave in marriage. And it is. Love is about compromise on both sides. And I just want to lift you both up right now to the Lord. And I speak full restoration on every relationship. Listen, it might be perfect in your eyes, but I'm just know God's the restorer of everything. And just right now, lay hands. Ore ba sheka ba to sotoro ba shanda kate sete. Hurra ba ba sheka to restore it. Everything that you have touched in their lives, Lord, even as they've come to you, mighty God, we know, God, that you are the one that brings us our identity. So right now, Lord, I just speak right now for complete restoration in each one of their lives, Lord. You know, even as you go through your own struggles,
you're beautiful. Ooh.
And as for Briggs and Trish, it's actually their first year anniversary today. So those that aren't slain in the spirit, we want to say happy, turn around and let the people see. Happy anniversary to Briggs and Trish. Married 1 year today. Hallelujah. Everything's happened so quickly. You know, when God's in it, the suddenlies happen. I tell you what, hey? Hallelujah. Now they're on their way starting a family. Well, not that kind of family. There's lots of people at the Hula House. The Hula House has got lots of babies. Hallelujah. Okay. Okay, you can strip that off the edit. Okay. Are you ready? Pray. Lift your hands towards them in Jesus' name right now. We pray that you'll move from glory to glory in this new relationship, this new marriage. Holy Spirit, that you will be the focus of everything. No matter what the gift is that they have been given, not only even in their new home, Lord, I pray that you will always be number one. You are the first. You are the gift giver. You are the source and the resource of everything. Lord, the head of this I speak right now. Whoa. Whoa. Oh, the anointing is so strong. I don't even have to touch you. It's all over you. More God, more God, more God, more God. Did you release a spirit of joy, prophet? Oh my, I think there's a spirit of joy that's hit this congregation. How have we got? Oh, we got some more couples. Oh wow, we got lots of couples in this house. Hallelujah. Lift your hands up. Hallelujah. Jesus' name. Ho, ho. Brosho kambarande shete. Broko shaka tesa. Oh my gosh, this is going to be hectic. Have we got anybody still left? Who have we got? Okay. All right. All right. In the name, the mighty name. Get ready for missions. Get ready for missions. Oh. Sometimes it's just awesome that the Holy Spirit's already got it, you know. Sometimes you don't even need the Holy Spirit has got it and Holy Spirit is on people. But now where does that leave us? Hallelujah. Oh, Lord, release a spirit of joy. Oh, God, I speak a spirit of joy right now to be released over the people so that they're ready to receive the word. A spirit of joy, God, a spirit of joy. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, my. Hallelujah. Don't let the devil. Don't let him get a foothold in your relationships. Don't let him stand on your heads. Don't let him stand on your faces. Don't let him stand on your bellies. Because those are the places where rivers of living water have to flow. I'm getting drunk up here. I said to the Lord, Lord, just give us such a euphoria this morning. I was thinking of this time of the year, and I was thinking of how, you know, it is such a norm for people to say, well, it's Christmas. Let my hair down. Yes, let your hair down. But let it be in the spirit. Get the spirit of joy, and you won't even have a headache. If you're going to be drunk in the spirit. Do you know what an awesome thing that is? It is the more awesome than any high that you can get from anything. Oh, yes, and if you don't have it, you just come up and you say, listen, Pastors, whoever it is, pray for me. I need a spirit of joy. I need whatever I need. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Release it, Lord. It's been a tough year for many of us this year. It's been a hard year. It's been a difficult year. But you know, there's nothing we go through that is not for our learning, that is not for God to fine-tune us and to build our character. Like Romans 5 says, you know, if you can just put it up there for me, please. Romans 5:1, Kerry. Thank you. Romans 5:1. Oh, they're all drunk at the in the AV. They're all drunk in the AV room. I can't even get their attention. Hallelujah. Somebody's still okay. Okay. Romans 5:1. Just put it up quickly. I'm not going to preach. We've got Prophet Shark coming up now. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Are you ready? Read it with me. Therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through Lord Jesus, through whom we've now gained access. Everybody say access. Tell someone you've got an access. You've got a pass to heaven. Into this grace in which we now stand. And we rejoice of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also, read it with me, rejoice in our, how many rejoice in their sufferings? No. Because we know that suffering produces what?
Perseverance.
Go back one. They're drunk. Spirit. Suffering produces what?
Perseverance.
And?
Perseverance,
character, and character. So how many know sometimes when we go through something, God's got us.
Amen.
And it's going to produce character.
Amen.
And it's going to build us.
Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
It's going to show us that we're prepared for what the next level is.
Amen.
We want to be prepared. Amen?
Yes.
How many know you need level before you can move to the next level? You need training about that level before you move to the next level.
Amen.
When you're in a job, you don't just get, well, some get thrown into the job, the next level, but most people get training, right?
Amen.
We have to be trained before we're ready, and we're moving into another level.
Amen.
So get ready, people, because God's about to move in unprecedented ways, and if we're able to move through these times and get through these times, knowing that Christ is our hope, knowing that as we persevere, God is with us.
Amen.
Then just know that we're going to be able to do what God needs us to do in the future.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Is everybody here still?
Amen.
Are you all here in your spirit? Amen.
Amen.
I'm going to call up Prophet Jacques to come. He's been waiting to preach since last week. So he's very eager. He's fired up and ready. Can you bring me that mic, please, Prophet M? That's the one we're using for preaching. And right now, just pray with me. Stretch out your hands because there's an anointing here. Right now, there's an anointing. Whoa, there's an anointing. Thank you, Lord, that it's by your spirit. It's by your spirit. And I pray right now, Lord. I pray right now, Holy Spirit, that every word, I speak the prophetic release, the prophetic atmosphere, Lord. Thank you, God, for what you have inside of his heart, Lord, that it would manifest, that your glory would manifest, and that, Lord, lives would be changed from your word, Lord, and from the expounding in his heart.
Yes.
So, Holy Spirit, touch him now with that new anointing. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Oh, come on. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We felt that the Spirit just wanted to draw people in to God. Amen?
Amen.
This morning, I just saw this picture of those that have stood, and I saw them scarred, wounded, because of the seasons that have been.
Yes.
And my heart cried.
Yeah.
And I just felt the Lord say, I am bringing refreshing. I am bringing renewing. I am bringing. I am the binder of the wounds. Even leaders that have stood for a long time on the chin, that have taken hits, that have been talked about, even untruths. People, we have a computer here. Doesn't matter how strong you are. When people say things about you, it sits somewhere in a file. And it can drag you down. I just feel a wind from the Lord that is going to pick us up and rejuvenate us and energize us and lift us up. We are not going down. We are going up. We're not going. We are going over.
Amen.
Amen. And this morning, Apostle just spoke about Christ in me, the hope of glory. And even the songs were so in line. Holy Spirit, how can we even move without you?
Yes.
We can't.
Yeah.
Holy Spirit is so wonderful. Turn to the person next to you, please, and say, open your heart. Open your mind for the prophetic word. The revealed word. Receive it. Say to that person, it's your day. Come on. Receive it. We are not downcast.
We're not
the tail.
We're
the head. Hallelujah.
Okay,
so let's go. This morning I'm going to speak to you prophetically. When a prophet speaks, they already prophesying. Okay? Because the word already prophesies. I'm going to speak to you under the heading, look, see, and behold. What an imagination. Look, see, and behold. Okay. What do you see? What do you see? What do you see? What do you see? Apostolic prophetic churches are seeing churches. How can you go anywhere if you cannot see? When the power goes out, like yesterday, we run for what? Candles, lamps, torches. Why? Because it's built in us. We need to see.
Yes, yes, that's true.
That is the prophetic church. It's a seeing church.
Amen.
So it's not just about having vision, which you have to have, but it's also to see into the invisible realm. To counteract, to find out what the devil is doing, and to bring forth a counteract.
Yes.
Yes. Amen. To preempt.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah. So, this is the year 5775. Yes?
Yes.
An apostle has shared on that. The year of doubles, 2 5s, 2 7s. Okay. Double, 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 and double anointing, blessing, double breakthrough. Amen.
Amen.
Yes.
Doors are going to open and to him has ordained it. God has put it into place. It has been established. It is the Lord's. Even though you have spoke to a lot of people and you've actually formed a network. God was behind it. I see the road has been laid out for you. Doors are already there. Some are even a little, I mean, it's like this. Some are wide open. But doors will continue to you. Watch 2015 and onwards. Amen?
Yeah.
So we need to look and look again in this year.
Yeah.
Amen? We need to see and see again. And we need to behold. Now, we are still in the Hebrew time of Aeon year.
Yes.
Right? We are still in, have been, and we are still going to be. Aeon means is to see. So God wants the church to see.
Yes.
Yeah. See. Amen? So, the year before was the year 5774, the year of the open door. What happened? The Lord moved a few of us. The Lord opened doors to you, and you moved into them.
Yeah.
In that year, the Lord opened a door for me. The Lord put things on hold. Wasn't easy, but and people said, you won't do it. You are too in your comfort zone. And I said, blah to you. I will do it. I will step through this new door into Durban.
Amen.
It's been fabulous. Great. Look at the just to relation here, the Lord tries to examine, inspect. I looked at these to exist to have quality. I spoke to you. I'm going to. Okay. If you are trying to line, the line is they can get in. Be misunderstood. People say, I don't know if I can continue. I'm only human. Hold the line!
Yes! Yes.
more, guess what?
Stand some more.
Stand some more. Yes. Christ in me.
Yes.
Lord, I'm telling you, I can't. No, Christ in me.
Yes.
I shall stand in you for you. What does hold mean? To stay firm.
Wow.
Refuse to yield.
Ooh, wow.
Now remember, we're in the year of behold.
Amen.
I'm going somewhere to grasp, to become established. An apostle again just said the whole thing this morning. And the songs. Are you beginning to understand the differences between look, see, and behold? See is a stronger word than look.
Yes.
I can look. A glance. What does see do?
With intent.
Have you ever thought to yourself, do people see me? Do you see me? I've heard the heart cry of people. They're basically saying, listen, do you see me? Do you see me? Or do you just give me a casual glance? Do you know who I am? Do you know how I feel? You know what I like? What I don't like? Do you know me? Last week the Lord began because I just felt this drawing into. Do you see me? Jesus is saying, the Lord is saying, do you see me? It came through Apostle this morning. God is saying, in this season, it's a season of behold, looking, seeing, because they all see words, right? Look, see, and behold. They're all seeing words. God is saying to us, this is the prophetic word. Do you see me? Christ in me, the hope of glory.
Yes.
Do you see me, church? Do you see me as the risen Yeshua? The risen King of Kings. Lord of Lords. Do you see me as your provider? Do you see me as your foundation? Do you see that day of glory shall not go under?
Yes.
Oh, come on.
Yes. Amen.
The Lord can at times put something on hold. Not forever. For a season. But if God is in it and your heart is pure, you don't have to be perfect. But if your heart is pure, if you are singing a song about the great Lord, and it brings tears to your heart, and you're just so moved, you say, Lord, you know, I love you. I make mistakes. I say the wrong things. I'm constantly in trouble. When they sing that song, not ankle deep, knee deep, waist deep, I'm thinking, oh my God. I always kind of get misunderstood or I say things. You don't have to be perfect. Do you see me? See stronger than look. Behold stronger than see and look. Let's quickly look at, in the Amplified, Revelations chapter 3, verse 20. I feel such a warmth in my spirit from the Lord to us. Does the Bible not say that the Lord does not grow weary? And that we shall mount up with wings as eagles? Who is a safe harbor? There's always one stronger you can lean on. Amplify. Rev. Chapter 3. Verse 20. says, behold, I stand at the door and I knock. Jesus is speaking. If anyone hears and listens to and heeds my voice, listens to me, opens the door, I will come in to him or her, and I will eat with them, and they shall eat with me. So we will share in the presence and the provisions of the Lord. Yes. But Jesus is saying, hey, I am. Yes. Who's the I am? The great I am says, hey, I'm at the door. I'm knocking. Knocking on this ministry, knocking on you individually, your friend, family. I am at the door. So when somebody knocks at the door, what do? You go look through the window and say, oh my God, do I actually want to see these people? Or you look through the little thing, little hole, whatever. People. And then if you open the door, Jesus, you open and then you give him a glance. But if you go further, you'll say, come in. Then you begin to talk. And then you begin to see. How many of you have been in a restaurant? There are waiters. Or you've been to the place where you park. You know that they are parking guards. Because you've given a look. How many of us actually see them? Nobody. When you see them coming, just get some money and practice. The car guards. You don't see them. Jesus says, behold, I am. I am. I am at your door. Open up, let me in. See me. And then he starts off, behold. Now he says, behold me. Behold is stronger. Behold is getting a grip on Jesus. Now it's inside of you. Christ in me. You have a grasp. You're occupying. You're taking the land. It's asserted. Now you are linked, united as one. Amen. That's behold. Not in look and in see. You must look and you must see, but you have to go to behold. This is what the Lord has been sharing with me now for days. And now I've got scriptures. It's too fast, so don't. Revelations chapter 21, verse 5 from the New King James. Behold, I make all things new. Yeah. So if you have beheld me, if you behold me, I will make things new. Don't give me a glance. Yes. Don't partially see me. Yes. Behold me for who I am. Yes. Then I will make all things new. That's good. Isaiah 43:19. Behold, I will do a new thing. Again, behold me. Don't glance at me. Behold me. 2 Corinthians 5:17. New King James. Behold, all things come new. When? When you behold me. Luke 10:19. Powerful. Behold! I give you the authority to trample on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy. But you have to behold me. You can't just glance at me and walk in the fullness and walk in the power and walk in all those things. No, you can't give me a casual glance. You have to behold me. My blood, my DNA has to flow through you. You have to have your identity because we are united as one. Now, in me and through me and by my power, we will flow. I will make all things new. I will give you authority. You shall trample on the enemy. Luke 17:10, amplify. Jesus says, for behold, the kingdom of God is within you, not because of a glance. We spoke this morning in the car. You know why there are seats empty? People are hardly even moved to see. If but they moved into sin.
Amen. Yes,
that's true. That's true.
It would get them even closer to be holy.
Yes.
But they give the Lord a casual glance.
Yeah.
We all do that at times. But we can't. The kingdom of God is within you. And then John 1:4. We beheld his glory. When we hold of the Lord Jesus, the glory is there. Christ in me, the hope of it. You want glory, BJ? Yes, Lord, behold me. Don't just glance at me from time to time. And then we beheld his glory. So the verb behold is a stronger word than look and see. It's not just passively looking and seeing. It's active, it's even aggressive. So, what does behold? I've taken be and taken hold. Put them together, this is what they mean. It's taking hold of, taking, keeping, taking possession. It's intense to gain, to not break under strain, to continue, Deo Gloria, to occupy, stay firm, yield. The Lord has got your back, Apostle. The Lord has got your back, Em. The Lord has got your back. The Lord has got the back of this church. We will not look at the minuses. We will not even pay attention to the negative. No, we will keep our eyes on who? The author and the finisher of our faith. I believe this is a season that the Lord is raising the level of faith in our hearts. We are going to believe for the miraculous in the beholding. Oh, can you imagine if we get this behold? Every time you open your eyes in the morning, demons are going to start sending each other messages. Look, this woman, this guy is awake. Send out the emergency call. Send the SMSs. They're awake! Intends to gain, to not break under strain, continue to occupy, to stay firm, refuse to yield, hold the line, hold your ground, to gain and keep possession. Let's quickly look at 2 Kings, chapter 6, verse 8 to 6. You know this. 2 Kings 6, 8 to 17 from the New King James. Let me paint you the picture. The king of Syria, Ben-Hadad, was making war on Israel in the story, okay? But Elisha was in the Israeli camp. The Lord was showing Elisha in the camp exactly what Syria was doing. In the spirit. The Lord said, they're going to go there, they're going to do that. So the Syrians couldn't win. Yeah? Because they had a seer in their midst. Do we need seers today?
Yes.
Do we need prophets today? Yes. Yeah. So Elisha was seeing what was going on. Amen? Amen? So the king of the enemy thought, no. I am going to send a mighty army to the camp where Elisha is. And we are going to capture him. Maybe thinking, if we have him, he can then hear things and see things for us. And then surely we will overcome Israel. So they sent this massive army. This army comes to the camp at night. Okay? So let's go to verse 15. When the servant of Elisha rose early, and went out. So he's like, he's out of his tent, and he walks out, and he goes, and he's in shock. Why? Why? Let's see. There was an army surrounding the city with horses and chariots. Today it's like tanks. And his servant said to him, Elisha, alas, my master, what shall we do? What must we do? Elisha answered, do not fear. There's a do not fear for every day in the Bible. Amen?
Amen.
Elisha says to him, hey, chill down, bro. Chill down, okay? Just chill. And then he said, do not fear, for those who are with us, Deo Gloria, are more than those who are with them. Elisha prayed and said, Lord, I pray, open the eyes of my servant. Then the Lord opened the servant's eyes and the young man, and he saw. And behold. So he saw. He first took a look at the tent. He said, oh my God, there's an army surrounding the camp. We're in trouble. Elisha said, shush man, I'm going to pray that you can see. He went from look to see. Now we're in behold. Behold, behold, behold.
Wow.
The mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha. What was this? A heavenly, supernatural, angelic host.
Yeah.
So here there they were. And here was the army of the enemy. But behind them and above them was this massive angelic host.
Hallelujah.
So Elisha says, hey, my friend, Bru, whatever. Can you see now?
Yeah.
One angel, takes one angel, not even 10, to basically come here and smash this mall to pieces. The word says in the Bible, the angels fight with the redeemed.
Amen.
We are more than the enemy.
Amen.
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 So to believe the impossible, one must first see and take hold of or behold the invisible. And it says here, seeing into the invisible is a key to victorious praying and interceding. Discerning spiritual issues from God's perspective rather than man's. We cannot watch the news and then react. I read a thing about Prophet King. He says he doesn't even look at the news.
Yes.
He won't even be by man's news. He gets his news from God. And he does what God says do. I'm not saying don't read the news. I'm telling you what King does. Okay? We have to see it from God's perspective. Keep our eyes on the author rather than man. Seeing the enemy's attack plan and perceiving God's angelic strike force. And take hold of that, owning it as a birthright. That is beholding. Let me finish. Ezekiel chapter 37. One of my favorites. I have preached on this before here. Okay? Ezekiel 37, verse 1 to 14. And it says this in the New King James. The hand of the Lord came upon me, Ezekiel, and brought me out in the spirit of the Lord, and set me down in the midst of the valley. And it was full of bones. Then the Lord caused me to pass by them all around. God made Ezekiel. There's a revelation here. Get it? God made Ezekiel walk around the valley. God wanted him to see it. There were very many in the valley, and indeed, they were very dry, or they were very dead. Nobody was like, no. Nobody was moving. God said, Ezekiel, walk around the valley, make sure that the bones are dead. So it says here, he caused me to pass them by, and behold, another behold. There were very many, and they were all dry. Then God said to me, son of man, God always asks us questions that he already knows the answer. Why? Because he wants us to know the answer. So God said to him, son of man, Now remember, son of Adam, son of man. This is before Jesus, son of man. Can these bones live? Is there any hope here? Can they live? So he scales them, so he says back, oh Lord God, you know. Again he said to me, prophesy to these bones, prophesy to these bones, and say to them, oh dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. God is giving instructions now on exactly what. So prophets have to hear and then speak as God directs. Okay? So the Lord says, prophesy to these bones and say to those bones, speak to your circumstances. O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. O open empty seats, hear the word of the Lord. O bank account, hear the word of the Lord. Now I'm not praying it over my own finances.
Yeah. Amen.
Are we covered? Thus says the Lord God to these bones, surely I will cause breath to enter into you and you shall live. How many times have we looked at something and said, you know, it's dead? I looked at the AR at the time and I knew God was going to stop it for a time or forever. If I had been stubborn and if I had held on to that had ended, I could not have moved into the new.
That's right.
To a place of beholding.
Yes, that's true.
Mm.
That's good.
Says the Lord God to these bones, surely I will cause breath into you, and you shall live. I will put sinews on you, bring flesh upon you, cover you with skin, put breath in you, and you shall live. Then you shall know. Then, after I've done that, you shall know that I am the Lord. So Ezekiel prophesied as he was commanded. He was commanded, faith comes by hearing, commanded, and I prophesied. As I did, there was a noise, and suddenly a rattling, and the bones came together, bone to bone to bone. Amen? Indeed, as I looked, the sinews and the flesh came upon them, and the skin covered them over, but there was no breath in them yet. Also God said to me, prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man, and say to the breath. Now remember, the prophet is hearing God speak, but God is putting God's word in his mouth to speak. I can prophesy as a human being to this pulpit. It's going to remain a pulpit. Unless the Lord God Almighty says to me, I want you to prophesy, you know, and do it this way, this way, this way, this way, and this is what you must say to this thing. Then it will. Amen. Prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man, and say to the breath, thus says the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath. Breathe on these slain, that they may live. So I prophesied as God commanded me, and breath came into them, and they lived and stood upon their feet, an exceeding great army. Out there is the army of ours, the army of God. Then he said to me, son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. They indeed say, our bones are dried off. We indeed say, Lord, I'm telling you, we have bills to pay. We need thousands. No, we need millions. I said to God before many times, Lord, I cannot have $10. The vision that I have, 10 rands will not help me. A million will not help. It will help, but it won't help. I need millions. We need millions upon millions upon millions upon millions. We need to rent stadiums. We need to get professional marketing companies, advertising companies. We need to go on TV. We need to do this big. We need to fill stadiums. Hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of thousands. Son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. They indeed say our bones are dry, our hope is lost, and we ourselves are cut off. Therefore, because they say that, prophesy and say to them, thus says the Lord God, behold, O my people, behold, O my people, behold me, my people, and I will open your graves, cause you to come up from your graves, and bring you into the land of Israel. Then you shall know, then after you beholded me, that I am the Lord. When I have opened your graves, O my people, and brought you from your graves, I will put my spirit in you, and you shall live, and I will place you in your own land. Then you shall know that I, the Lord, have spoken it and performed it. Who spoke it? God did through the prophet. Who performed it? God did through the prophet, says the Lord. Now, take note, as I'm finished. There's two beholds in this place. The first behold, God wanted Ezekiel to make very sure that these people were dead, that the bones were dry, that there were no, that there wasn't any hope. God wanted him to really grasp it, behold it, and say, God, they dead. Why? Because God was setting Ezekiel up for the second behold. So now we, because we are flesh and we have eyes, we're not stupid. If I look at my bank account, if I put my little card into that machine, and that machine is fighting me, and letters are coming onto that ATM, don't do it, don't do it, don't do it, take the card out. You're deep in the red. And I say, shut up. Give me my money. How many times do we we are confronted with hopelessness, impossibility? God wanted Ezekiel to know it. Because the Lord asked him a question. Can these bones live? Ezekiel said, well, you know. And God said, okay, cool. Play that game. Let's do this. Bang. Yes, the army of Israel. Alive. Then the Lord says, behold, a second time. After this, Ezekiel could say, I have beheld the glory of the Lord. The power of the Lord. We are going to testify internationally, apostle and them and the team and prophet, and perhaps I'll go with it at some point, I don't know. Well, actually I do know. We will be able, the Lord sends you or sends us, to stand is, you know what? This is where we were.
Amen.
We beheld it.
Yes.
Amen. This is where we are now.
Yes. Amen.
We behold it.
Yes.
This is what the Lord has done.
Yeah.
Now we are here to prophesy.
Yeah.
The living Jesus into your church.
Yeah.
And get those cheers.
Amen. And
the money flowing, and the blessing moving, and signs, wonders, and miracles. Look, see, and behold. You have to look to see, but you can't stop there. You have to move into behold, into hey. So it's been look and see, and look again and see. Sometimes I'll walk past and I'll give you a look, but then I'll look again, maybe I'll look again, and I'll stop. And I'll say, hi. I'm John, and you'll say, hi, I'm Briggs. Now we're beginning to see. Now we're talking, oh, I'll do this. Now the seeing comes. But that must take us to behold it. If we are to become united and friends, real friends.
Yes, yes.
Do you see me, church? Do you see me? Last week was draw into me. This morning it was clear. Christ in me, the hope of glory. This glory, this whole thing was about in God.
Yes.
Apostle just spoke from his spirit. The songs were there. Just in me. I'm a safe place.
Wow. Just before you leave the pulpit, you know, prophet, I didn't know you're not finished.
If I may, I prepared this before I saw this, what Chuck Pierce put in here last week. So I had done this. Okay, it was finished. And he says, rise up, my people. This is your finest hour. This is due season and time to receive the anointing of this day. It's time to stand up and walk on the path of the new beginning that I have prepared and that I am sending you on. Your advance will be more glorious than it has ever been. Your adventures will be greater than anything you have experienced in the past. I will go with you and walk. No, this is not the one. No, I'm sorry, I'm wrong. It's this one. This is a season where you are going higher than you have ever imagined. I'm taking you higher and higher. You have only begun to glimpse, that is seen, glimpse, or that's where I'm taking you. Raise your sights. Raise your sights. Raise your eyes. It says it here. Look at me. I didn't see this before I done that. Okay? Look at me. I'm taking you higher and higher. There are certain things you can't see where you presently are. You begin to become buoyant in faith with me. You will not be able to see what would have you see. So keep going higher and you'll get a place where you can breathe only by the Spirit. Also talks about seeing and taking.
Just before you leave, what's so powerful is when I taught on behold and I taught on look and see at the beginning of or in September when we moved into the new year, we remember that seeing was to gaze upon, like you've said, to look and see, to gaze upon. But to behold is to perceive and understand. To perceive and understand it. And I believe that that's what Prophet Jacques has been saying to us this morning, is that the time of just looking, the time of just gazing, we need to perceive now and understand the revelation that is being unfolded before us. And just to look is to spend a little time, but to behold means you've got to draw in. You've got to open that door. And this morning, will you stand with me? And I want to ask if there's anyone here this morning, stay with me, Prophet Jacques, and then we can just pray over people. If there is anyone that wants ministry this morning, where you're saying, Lord, I've been looking. I've been looking, and I've looked in so many areas, and I've looked and I've gazed upon so many things. And now I've gazed upon your face. But Lord, I want to behold your glory. I want to behold your beauty. And even as you've began to touch me this morning, even as you've began to minister to me this morning, Lord, I want more. I want to perceive and I want to understand. And if that's you this morning, you're saying, Lord, I want the revelation. I want that fullness. I want the revelation. I want to know what it is to behold you. I want to know what it is to perceive and understand. And if that is you this morning, just come up quickly. Just come up quickly. Just come up quickly. We're going to pray over you. We're going to touch you right now by the power of Holy Spirit. Just come up right now. If you're saying, Lord, I have a hunger in me. I need to know more. I want to perceive. I want to understand. Just come up. Just come up. Don't be afraid to come up. Just if you're saying, Lord, I need that revelation in my life to keep going. I need that revelation to move into the next level. I need that revelation to come into the ordained purpose for my life. If that's you this morning, lift your hands up. Lift your hands up. Lift your hands up. Come, Prophet, just pray. Lord, I speak right now that there would be a beholding, Lord, a understanding, a depth, even that there's a prophetic anointing on you, anointing to intercede. Behold in Jesus' name. Bro shande rabakate basondo robo shande kurabaka come Prophet Jacques. Bro shakabate baba shondo Hurabashanda, you have looked and you have seen that God is good. You have seen and touched. And now the Lord says, I want to show you my face. I want to show you my glory. I want you to perceive and understand. Poshakaba, brosho kote rabashondo, brondo kote bande, brosho koba bashanda. Behold, behold, behold the fire of God to touch you, that you would perceive and understand with a heart, Lord. A heart that comes by the power of your Spirit. More, Lord. More glory, Lord, on her now, Jesus. Brosho kumba rabba shanda. Behold my daughter. Wow. Behold. More, God. More, God. Brosha kabasha. Brosha ba 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 ba. Lay hands on her. Brosha kababa ba. You're right. Oh. Impartation of glory. Morabashanda. Broshokobababa. Who was standing up here earlier? Busha. Oh, come and receive it, sister. Come and receive the double portion. Oh, mighty God, lift your hands up. Oh, Kabashata, Shakata, you are going to spend much more time in the presence of the Lord. The Lord is calling you. Place, the secret place. The Lord says, there are things beyond measure that I will show you, my child. There's a prophetic anointing on your life. Broshoko, and besides just what you understand to be your calling, the enemy has tried to steal. He's tried to take away. He's tried to bring it. But right now the Lord says, I've spoken. And my anointing has been placed upon you. The mantle to which I have placed upon you has been placed upon you. And even now, Lord, I accelerate right now. I cover you with that mantle in Jesus' name. Oh. One more thing before we close, and then we're going to close. Prophet Jock just had a sense of something. If you want to just stand for a moment.
Yes.
Oh, there's an anointing.
We heard the word, but the word is what if we don't act. I want you to please stand in faith. Okay, and I want us to prophesy to every seed here. I want to prophesy to this church. Amen. And we want to say, live dry bones. Amen. Almighty God, this morning we speak to these empty chairs, Lord, but we see them full. We see them, Lord, there are many, many, many names, Lord, that occupy these churches. And God, by your power and by your word, we prophesy life, we prophesy life, we prophesy life, we prophesy life, Lord, into